Fantastic opportunity to sail a 75-foot expedition yacht, Abel Tasman. If you're sailing a 75-foot expedition yacht anywhere in Sweden, you're going to Stora Karlsö. Stora Karlsö is a small island just off the west coast of Gotland, Sweden's biggest island. These islands make up an ancient coral reef that over millions of years of tectonic movements have traveled from south of the equator all the way up into the Baltic Sea. Stora Karlsö is one of the world's three first protected natural areas and home to a unique biodiversity. It gives a prehistoric, far from everything kind of feeling, and it is one of our favorite places in the Baltic Sea. Here we met up with Olof Olsson, an ecologist who has spent decades on this island studying some of its most interesting inhabitants, the Guillemots and Razorbills. The two following days we spent helping Olof and a team of his researchers gather data, making observations offshore from the deck of Abel Tasman.
Yeah, so I'm Olof Olsson. I'm one of two project leaders of the Seabird project here at Stora Karlsö. My background is that I have a PhD in ecology, and I did my work on king penguins in South Georgia, and also been working in seabirds in northern Norway and Svalbard and so on. But now it's here in the Baltic Sea on this lovely island, and this is the largest, by far the largest seabird colony in the Baltic Sea. And there's about, if you count all the individuals of seabirds on this island, connected to this island, is about 100,000 seabirds, and they it's a really hot spot for biodiversity in the Baltic Sea.
Right, and you do especially a lot of work on the guillemots.
Yes, and it was in the late 1800s, it was less than 50 pairs left on this island, and this was the only spot they were breeding. So there was some guys that thought, try to save the guillemots here on this island, and they actually bought the entire island and made one of the first protected areas in the world. I think it's the third area after Yellowstone and one place in Australia, and this is the third in the world, and with a specific purpose to save the common guillemot here, and they succeeded, and now it's more than 20,000 pairs of common guillemots breeding here.
Okay, and something that is
My name is Astrid Karlsen, and I'm a PhD doctoral student at the Baltic Seabird Project here at Stora Karlsö.
All right, so now we're out sailing. We are about 2.5 miles from outside Stora Karlsö. So could you tell me why we went up at 3 a.m. this morning?
Yeah, well, yesterday we did a midday transect where we were basically doing an assessment of where the birds are flying each given time of day and how many are flying. We want to see the direction from the island and outwards. So what we're interested in seeing right now is basically, are they going north more in one particular part of the day, or are they going more south or east, west, and how abundant do we see more birds flying to one specific direction? And also we want to pick up on whether they're carrying fish or not, because the fish is obviously carried to their chick. So if they're just foraging for themselves, you can't see that they are carrying anything. But if they're bringing a fish back, then that means that they are provisioning for young. And we are interested in knowing whether there is some particular locations or patches that they go to specifically to forage for their chicks versus foraging for themselves.
All right. It must be very interesting and very fun to work in a place we have a seabird colony that is doing very well compared to other places in the world. I'm sure that many biologists working in the field are seeing quite a different picture.
Yes and no. I mean, it is very both encouraging to see that there are things that can be done and there are ways to increase the population. But at the same time, I have to say that I find it quite terrifying to see the skew in the biodiversity that we're seeing in this area. I mean, the reason why the seabirds are doing well is because their competitors are doing worse. And we are just as, like, you see that there's a disbalance in the food web, basically, where it's skewed from being several species foraging together on the same subspecies or the same lower hierarchy of the food chain to being a couple of dominating species that are doing extremely well, both in the lower hierarchical level of the food web and also as top predators, which the seabirds are. So it is worrying to see how unbalanced it is.
Yeah.
Yet at the same time, it's by no means hopeless, and I think there's a lot of things that we people can do to re-establish the sort of balance that we need. At the same time, if we re-establish this balance, it means that we are going to have to see a decline in the seabird population, which, of course, again, is uncomfortable, but yeah, it's the truth. They can't continue growing like this, and they're growing because other species are doing worse.
Mm.